Hello everyone, today I am here to go for another discussion, and this is one thing that is important whenever we plan to do a research protocol. This is the most important aspect that is most of the time overlooked. So today I'll be talking about informed consent document, and I would try to have it as simple as possible. And if at the end of this session it helps you out or it gives you some concept of what an informed consent document is and what is its role in research protocol, the purpose of this presentation is solved or it is fulfilled. So I would be talking about one particular aspect today, and that particular aspect is informed consent document. Now, before we start this informed consent document, we often tend to use this term consent in one way or the other, whether we want to go for an operative procedure or we want to go for any other procedure, we tend to use this particular term consent. Now, the consent that we are talking about in this particular presentation is the context that is in relation to your research protocol. So, in the research protocol, we talk about the informed consent document, which is also known as ICD, which forms an essential part of the your research protocol. And this is where the ethical committee looks into this particular consent document over how well your document is prepared and how well you are equipping the patient about your research proposal. So I would be starting this particular preparation with what exactly do we mean by an informed consent document or an informed consent process. Sometimes we label it as an informed consent process. So what I would be doing out here is I would be highlighting what an informed consent is. So informed consent is a process where you tend to acknowledge the respect for the person. One of the essential aspects of medical ethics is autonomy. Autonomy means autonomous. That means that you have told the patient, you have given all the information pertaining to the research to the patient, and it is his will without any undue influence. It is his will whether he wants to decide to go with the research protocol or he does not want to go with it. You cannot force the patient. So that is what this particular informed consent document deals with. This particular document definitely is not a legal document, which most of us tend to confuse or tend to keep in our mind that once we have taken a consent, we are safe. This is not a risk management tool of an investigator or an institution, and foremost, it is not a formality. It is the informed decision of the patient that he agrees to participate in the study. That is what an informed consent document means. So by no way it is a formality that you are taking an informed consent document. So whenever we want to talk about clinical research, what should be there, what are the various things that should be there in informed consent documents? Some of the criteria or some of the points that should be there is the first of all that this is a voluntary participation. That is the first thing that the patient, you need to tell the patient that it is a voluntary participation. There are alternative therapies that exist, and it is quite likelihood that the patient might not attain any benefit from that particular therapy. And you also need to mention that the awareness of degree and type of risk in human is lacking or maybe is deficit or whatever is the situation. Maybe we are talking about a particular protocol where we are sufficiently aware about the knowledge of a particular therapy. So we might be knowing almost everything. But again, the type of risk in human, exactly what type of risk that might be lacking in a clinical research. That is one angle that you need to tell the patient. Now, this informed consent document, the process that has gained a wide significance today, is due to certain sentinel events that happened in the past century. And so I'll be highlighting some of those events that led to the present form of informed consent document. The first event that I would like to highlight out here is the Nazi war crime. I believe all of you know about the Nazi war crime. There were concentration camps, and in these concentration camps, humans were subjected to various research protocols, processes. And following this World War II, Nuremberg trial was introduced in 1948. Then there was another study that was done on human radiation, and various experiments were performed, and obviously there was a leak, there was a risk with human radiation. Following this particular risk, we had the Declaration of Helsinki that was coined in 1963, and it is updated every now and then. The third study that was done, the third sentinel event, is maybe around 40 years back or 45 years back. This was the Tuskegee syphilis study. Now, this particular study was done in US, and it was done on a different set of race, and they were not given proper treatment. Although penicillin was available at that particular time, they were not given proper treatment because they wanted to study the complications that were related to syphilis. So based upon this, there was National Commission Belmont report that was framed in 1977. So these are few events. There are many more. Maybe in the coming few slides, I might tell you some more events that were there, and that is how this particular consent document has attained such an important role in clinical research. Now, when we talk about the definition of an informed consent, what I would like to highlight out here is that this particular consent is voluntarily, it is willingness, informed, and relevant. So if I go by the definition, this is a process by which a subject voluntarily confirms his or her willingness to participate in a particular trial after he has been informed about all the aspects of the trial that are relevant for that particular participant to participate in the study. Now, there is a term mentioned out here that is subjects. This term is now not considered a part of clinical research because it is considered a derogatory remark, and most of the time we tend to use the term participants or patients. Subjects is usually avoided when we talk about the clinical research participants. So out here, the highlight or the important point in the definition is it is voluntary, there is willingness, the patient is informed, and it is relevant for the individual to participate in this particular study. Now, there are various types of informed consent, which can be three types. There could be a written consent, there could be a verbal consent, and there could be a waived consent. So written consent by far, or it is one of the most important and ideal thing that should be done in all the research. There are certain situations where we go for a verbal consent, where we are only taking the records of the patient and nothing is involved. We are not disclosing the identity of the patient. Only we are looking into the records and there is minimal risk involved. Then there is another term that is used, that is waived consent, where no more than minimal risk is involved, the rights and welfares of the patients are not affected, and it is not possible to carry out research, additional information. Now, there is this particular clause that tends to add to it. Additional information will be given to the participants from time to time. If waiver consent is given, this is subject to the decision of the Institutional Ethics Committee whether they want to go for a waiver consent, where they find that there is no more than a minimal risk involved in the participant's involvement in the study and his rights and welfare are not affected. So So in that particular thing, there is a clause that is mentioned that additional information would be given to the participant from time to time. So these are the three types of informed consent documents: the written informed consent, the verbal informed consent, and the waived informed consent. Most of the time, the ideal thing that we should follow is the written informed consent. Then there is another set of term that is used there, that is the vulnerable subjects or the vulnerable participants. These vulnerable participants are based upon the US Code of Federal Regulation 46.111. These vulnerable populations are people who are at risk or who might be influenced to participate in the study by one method or the other. These participants include the children, the prisoners, pregnant women, mentally disabled, economically disadvantaged, educationally disadvantaged, those participants who require extra protection, and there is a lack of understanding in these participants for the clinical research or clinical trial. These are the vulnerable subjects. If I talk about economical disadvantage, maybe you are giving, you tend to give, okay, because you are participating in my clinical research, I'll give you maybe some amount that would take care of your needs. So that is undue influence that we are trying to use, and this study then stands null and void. So that economical, this is where we need to be specially precautious. And these, whether the vulnerable participants are involved or not, this is where the role of institutional ethics committee comes into play. Now there are certain situations where you do not require informed consent, where benefits are possible with research under consideration. There are many research, and in the present scenario, I don't need to tell you, there are fast track research going on, and then where you are maintaining adequate confidentiality. That means that nowhere you are mentioning or you are disclosing the detail of the patient, where it is okay that you do not go for a research or informed consent, or where the link with the participant or the link with the patient is broken. Maybe there is a third party who is undertaking, wants to just verify the records, or maybe a survey going on. In that particular situation, you do not have a link with the patient, and that if that link is broken in that particular situation, informed consent might not be required. Then there are certain situations where research has important potential benefits, and it cannot be completed on healthy volunteers. It requires a special group of population and involves minimal risk. There, where we are only using the medical records, you don't need to go for, you can go for a waiver of the informed consent, or where you are using in human tissues, maybe various specimens, where there is these specimens, maybe they were kept or stored, and you are using those specimens without any identity of the patient. So there is a, this is a byproduct of surgical intervention or stored clinical material, where there is no way you can come to know about the identity of the patient. In that situation, even waiver of informed consent can be given by the institutional ethics committee. So these are certain situations where informed consent might not be required. But again, it is solely the ethics committee that would decide whether they want to give you a waiver of an informed consent or not. Once ethics committee gives the waiver of the informed consent, in that particular situation, you can go ahead. These are certain areas where informed consent is not required. Now, coming to a designing of the informed consent, the most important part where we tend to fall prey to. It has to be very simple, and it has to be in a English language that could be understood by a student of class 3rd to 6th. So whenever we are designing an informed consent document, we always should start with the statement that you are invited to. So what does this mean, you are invited to? It means that you are not forcing the patient, and you are soliciting the presence of patient to come to join the research. The sentences that are used in this informed consent should be short, simple, and direct sentences. We should use words and phrases that can be comprehended by a student who is studying in class 3rd to 6th. Unnecessarily medical terms should be avoided. And if at all there are certain situations where medical terms are to be used, it should be used consistently and it should be described to the patient. No technical language should be used, and if it is used, it should be fully explained. Split your study into paragraphs with suitable heading, and no more than one idea should be there for a particular paragraph. So you should have a paragraph with suitable headings. Let's say it is something like a frequently asked questions type of a scenario, where we tend to design certain frequently asked questions and then we answer those questions in the detail. We tend to highlight or we tend to take care of only one aspect or one particular point at that particular time, not beyond that. The text that should be written, it should provide meaningful information and there should not be any confusion. The first page of the informed consent document should always contain the detail of the search. The next pages should have the purpose, the objectives, the background, the drug, if used, its benefits, harms, rights and responsibility, and confidentiality. This particular thing is important. You have to take confidentiality into consideration and you have to disclose it to the participant who all would have an access to your documents, to the data that you are providing us. The last page should contain the information that the participant had read and understood the study, the design of the study, the purpose of the study, all the pros and cons, and he is willing to participate in the study. There should be a column for signature, the person who is obtaining the consent, and if witness is required. Supposedly, there is maybe a participant who is illiterate. It is quite possible in a country like ours where we have illiterate participants. So we take the thumb impression, and in this particular situation, we need to have an impartial witness. Now, this impartial witness should be a person who is not related to our team. He should not be a paramedic, he should not be a nurse, he should be a person who is just there. And this impartial witness should sign on that particular informed consent. The other thing that you need to keep in mind whenever we are looking for the signature, the informed consent document bears the signature of the participant as well as the principal investigator. And both these participants have to sign and write the date. And it should be the date should be the same date as the date of the participant. It is not that the participant is signing today and maybe after 5 days the investigator signs all the documents. That is not there. That is not an appropriate, or that is not the right thing to do. You need to sign on the same day that you have explained this. And if there is one more thing that you would like to add to this, if the participant says that he wants to take this informed consent document to his home and wants to discuss with his family, you should give him an appropriate time so that he can discuss it, and it should be voluntary and he should have willingness to participate in the study. Now, wherever we require an HIV testing, there should be a separate page for it. The font, the size, and the margins, all these things are to be taken care of. Avoid any abbreviation in between. Abbreviations are good for a person who is aware of the medical field. For a layman, abbreviations do not tend to be helpful. If possible, you could use graphics or pictures. Maybe you want to include a patient, you want to show the injury mark, you want to show the burn patient, something like that. In that situation, you could depict it by the image of a human body, where this particular site, what are the sites involved, all these things. Even those things give a clear picture to the participant. And now there is another thing that is there, that even video has to be made. Now at this particular moment, in certain situations, even video has to be made of the informed consent process. So you have to code that video, and appropriately it has to be kept. And this is one of the most important points. The copy of the informed consent has to be given to the research participant. You cannot deny the research participant a copy of the informed consent. Now, this is not a one-time process. Let's have something very clear. This is a part, and it is an ongoing dialogue to describe the study and allay any worry and fear that the participant might have. It is not that once you have taken this informed consent, you are free to go ahead with the study. You don't need to explain anything to the patient. That is not the case. Whatever updates you give, you need to describe it to the patient. You need to take care that he does not have any worry or fear regarding the informed consent, and that has to be accordingly justified or explained to the patient in course of time. It is always the investigator, the physician, who should be the person who should be taking the informed consent document for medical treatment, although a non-physician can assist for the same. But the principal investigator should be the person who should be taking the informed consent process. Now, it follows a cycle. This informed consent follows a cycle. That is, you have a review and discussion of the informed consent document. You give him time for queries and answer. You give him time to discuss with family and friends. He comes to you, again review and discuss the informed consent. If he has any further problem, go give him, answer his queries, give him time to discuss. So this is an ongoing process. It is not a one-time event. Please keep this in mind, that this informed consent document is not a one-time event. It is a regular process. This is a cycle that has to keep on moving every now and then. If there are any queries that come in between the study, those queries have to be answered by the principal investigator to the patient or the participant, whoever is the, whatever the case may be in the research. Now, there are certain important points that I would like to mention out here for informed consent document. These are, first thing is that if supposedly the patient does not participate in the study, you cannot deny the treatment. Confidentiality is important, and the participant has the right to withdraw from the study any time. The language should be best the patient, which the patient understands. It could be a regional language. If it is a regional language, you need to go for a vernacular translation of the informed consent. And mind you, this vernacular translation also has to get an approval from the Institutional Ethics Committee. It should be in a very simple language. The copy of this informed consent should be given to the patient. The study design the participant should be aware about the study design. There should be no coercions. There should be no influence and no monetary benefit to the participant to participate in the study. So this is all regarding the informed consent document. I hope I have been able to solve some of your queries, or I have been able to take care of some of the aspects, and I hope you would like it. And if there are any queries, you can get back to me, or you can write down in the inbox and I'll get back to you. Thank you.